Welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. This is a complete course for the CCNP ENCOR, Enterprise Core, exam. In this video, we'll continue our study of spanning tree protocol by looking at two optional spanning tree features, UplinkFast and BackboneFast. Here's what we'll cover in this video. We'll cover two optional features from the so-called STP toolkit, both of which aim to speed up reconvergence after a topology change. First, we'll look at UplinkFast, which speeds up recovery from direct link failures. I'll introduce what that means in the next slide. Then we'll cover BackboneFast, which speeds up recovery from indirect link failures. And we'll cover what an indirect link failure is in this video too. Let's get started with UplinkFast. Here's a basic STP topology we'll use to demonstrate both UplinkFast and BackboneFast. We have switch 1, switch 2, and switch 3. Switch 1 is the root bridge, and the switch 2, switch 3 link is blocked because switch 3 G01 is non-designated. UplinkFast is a Cisco proprietary optional STP feature that speeds up a switch's recovery from a direct link failure on its uplink to the root bridge. From a spanning tree perspective, an uplink is a link toward the root bridge. In other words, the root port's link. Switch 2's uplink is via G00, its root port. And switch 3's uplink is also via its root port, G00. A direct link failure is a failure on one of the switch's directly connected links. For example, a failure on the switch 1, switch 3 link is a direct link failure from switch 3's perspective. So what exactly does UplinkFast do? It allows the switch to transition a non-designated port immediately from the blocking state to the forwarding state after a direct link failure affecting the current root port. So it's meant for switches that have at least one non-designated port, like switch 3. Configuring UplinkFast on switch 2, for example, isn't going to help if its root port goes down. The command to enable UplinkFast is simple: spanning tree UplinkFast in global config mode. Note that you should only enable it on the required switches, switch 3 in this case. That's different than the other topic of this video, BackboneFast, which should be enabled on all switches. So let's review what happens from switch 3's perspective after a direct link failure without UplinkFast. First of all, I activate STP debugging on switch 3. Let me reiterate that debugs are an amazing tool for both troubleshooting and for studying how different protocols work, so make sure to experiment with them when doing labs. So a direct link failure occurs on the switch 1, switch 3 link, without UplinkFast. To simulate that, I just shut down switch 3's G00 interface. So what happens after that? Well, switch 1 G01 and switch 3 G00 enter the disabled state. Switch 3, having lost its root port, makes G01 its new root port, its new uplink, pointing toward the root bridge, switch 1. G01 then enters the listening state for 15 seconds, then the learning state for 15 seconds. Finally, switch 3 G01 enters the forwarding state. I think you know the process by now. There is a total of 30 seconds of downtime. That's how long it takes by default. If only there was a feature to help switch 3's new uplink forward faster. Oh wait, there is. It's called UplinkFast. I've re-enabled switch 3 G00, so let's see how a direct link failure works with UplinkFast. First, I configured it on switch 3 with spanning tree UplinkFast. Note that enabling UplinkFast sets the bridge priority to 49152, which is 49153 on switch 3 because of the extended system ID for VLAN 1. This is to ensure that the switch doesn't become the root bridge, which defeats the purpose of UplinkFast. UplinkFast's goal is to allow the switch's uplink to the root bridge to recover quickly after a failure. It's designed for switches that aren't the root bridge. So I once again simulated a failure on the switch 1, switch 3 link by shutting down switch 3 G00. Then switch 1 G01 and switch 3 G00 enter the disabled state. And switch 3 G01 becomes a root port. So the process is the same so far. Here's where UplinkFast changes it. Switch 3 G01 then enters the forwarding state immediately. If you look at the timestamps that I've highlighted, at the same second, actually the same millisecond, that it becomes a root port, it enters the forwarding state. And at the end of the second log message, it says UplinkFast in brackets. So with less than 1 second of downtime, Switch 3 now has a functioning uplink, a root port, toward the root bridge. So that's UplinkFast. It helps a switch recover from a direct link failure by immediately transitioning a non-designated port to the root role in the forwarding state. Now let's move on to its brother, BackboneFast. BackboneFast is another Cisco proprietary optional STP feature, and it speeds up a switch's recovery from an indirect link failure. You can probably guess what that means, since you know what a direct link failure is. An indirect link failure is a failure on a link that isn't directly connected to the switch. And that means that the switch can't detect the failure, unlike when a link it's directly connected to goes down. A failure on the Switch 1, Switch 2 link is an indirect failure from Switch 3's perspective. Switch 3 won't be able to detect if that link goes down. BackboneFast allows a switch to skip the max age timer and immediately put a non-designated port into the listening state and the designated role after receiving an inferior BPDU from a neighbor. I'll demonstrate exactly how that works soon. Enabling BackboneFast is simple. The command is spanning tree BackboneFast. But unlike UplinkFast, you should enable it on all switches in the LAN. It won't work if you only enable it on Switch 3, for example. To understand the benefit of BackboneFast, let's review what happens without it. We've covered this process before, so let's go through it quickly. So an indirect link failure, that is indirect from Switch 3's perspective, occurs on the Switch 1, Switch 2 link. Switch 1 and Switch 2's G00 interfaces enter the disabled state. So Switch 2 has lost its path to the root bridge. What does it do? Switch 2 doesn't receive BPDUs from Switch 3. Switch 3 G01 is non-designated, and therefore doesn't forward BPDUs from Switch 1 to Switch 2. So Switch 2 doesn't know that it can still reach the root bridge via G01. As a result, Switch 2 declares itself the root bridge, and starts sending inferior BPDUs to Switch 3 via G01. Switch 3 receives those BPDUs, but ignores them because it is still receiving superior BPDUs from Switch 1. Here's debug output on Switch 3. Switch 3 hears Switch 2 announcing itself as the root bridge, but doesn't accept Switch 2 as the root bridge. So Switch 3 just ignores Switch 2 for now. After Switch 3 G01's max age timer expires, which takes about 20 seconds, it becomes a designated port in the listening state, as the debug output shows. It remains in this state for 15 seconds, as you know. Switch 3 also starts forwarding Switch 1's BPDUs to Switch 2, because G01 is now a designated port. As a result, Switch 2 accepts Switch 1 as the root bridge again, and Switch 2 G01 becomes a root port. And Switch 3 G01 continues progressing to the learning state for 15 seconds. And finally, Switch 3 G01 reaches the forwarding state, and STP has reconverged. The total downtime is about 50 seconds. You know this process by now, but how can BackboneFast speed it up? Let's see how it works. So starting from the same original LAN, let's see how BackboneFast improves reconvergence time. First of all, I enabled BackboneFast on all three switches. If you're using BackboneFast, make sure to enable it on all switches. So the same link failure occurs on the Switch 1, Switch 2 link. Switch 1 and Switch 2 G00 enter the disabled state. And because Switch 2 doesn't receive BPDUs from Switch 3, Switch 2 doesn't know it can still reach the root bridge via G01. Switch 2 declares itself the root bridge, and starts sending inferior BPDUs to Switch 3 via G01. So far, everything is the same as before, without BackboneFast. But here is where things change. Upon receiving an inferior BPDU from Switch 2, Switch 3 sends a root link query, RLQ request, out of its root port. This is BackboneFast coming into play. The purpose of the RLQ request is to check if the switch it thinks is the root bridge, switch 1, is really the root bridge, or if switch 2 is correct. Basically, switch 3 tells switch 1 that switch 2 is claiming to be the root bridge, and asks switch 1 to confirm that switch 1 is still the root. Switch 1 confirms that it is still the root bridge by sending an RLQ response to switch 3. Upon receiving switch 1's RLQ response, switch 3 makes G01 a designated port in the listening state, bypassing the max age timer. So that's how BackboneFast speeds up reconvergence. Normally, switch 3 would wait for G01's max age timer to expire before making G01 designated. In this case, it moved there immediately. The rest of the process is the same. Now that switch 3 G01 is designated, it forwards switch 1's BPDUs to switch 2, and switch 2 accepts switch 1 as the root bridge again, making G01 its root port. Finally, switch 3 G01 proceeds through the learning state, again for 15 seconds, and reaches the forwarding state. So, 30 seconds of downtime. BackboneFast allowed switch 3 to quickly confirm that switch 2 is wrong in claiming to be the root bridge, and then switch 3 informed switch 2 that switch 1 is still the root bridge, skipping the max age timer. There is a debug spanning tree BackboneFast command, but unfortunately it's not available in these CML switches. However, we can confirm after the fact with show spanning tree BackboneFast. Here's the output on switch 3. Number of inferior BPDUs received, 1. Switch 3 received 1 inferior BPDU from switch 2. Number of RLQ requests sent, 1. Switch 3 sent 1 RLQ request PDU to switch 1, as a result of receiving switch 2's inferior BPDU. Number of RLQ responses received, 1. That's the RLQ response from switch 1. And then one port, G01, transitioned as a result of BackboneFast. And here's switch 1. Switch 1 received 1 RLQ request PDU from switch 3, and sent 1 RLQ response back to switch 3. For review, here's a sample LAN with an access and distribution layer. At the access layer, where switches are expected to have non-designated ports, you should implement both UplinkFast and BackboneFast. Remember, UplinkFast is only necessary on switches that have non-designated ports. At the distribution layer, UplinkFast is not necessary. Neither of these switches should be blocking any ports. However, remember that for BackboneFast to work, it should be configured on all switches, so that includes these two distribution layer switches. Okay, before the quiz, let's review what we covered. First, we covered UplinkFast, which speeds up recovery from direct link failures. The switch immediately transitions a non-designated port to be a root port in the forwarding state, skipping the listening and learning states. It should be enabled on switches with non-designated ports, so access layer switches. Then we covered BackboneFast, which speeds up recovery from indirect link failures. After receiving an inferior BPDU from a neighbor, the switch sends an RLQ request to confirm if the root bridge is still available. And the root bridge, if it is alive, replies with an RLQ response. After receiving the response, the switch skips the max age timer and transitions the non-designated port to designated in the listening state. So this cuts off about 20 seconds from the process. BackboneFast should be enabled on all switches if you're using it. Okay, now let's move on to the quiz. Here's quiz question 1. Switch 1, an UplinkFast-enabled switch, loses its root port. How much time does UplinkFast save by rapidly transitioning its non-designated port to become a root port? Pause the video now to think about the correct answer. Okay, the answer is C, 30 seconds. Here's the process again. If the switch 1 switch 3 link fails, switch 3 G01 immediately becomes a root port in the forwarding state. It skips the listening and learning states, therefore saving 30 seconds of time. Okay, let's go to question 2. Which timer or state is skipped upon receiving a positive RLQ response from the root bridge? Pause the video now to think about the answer. Okay, the answer is A, max age. Instead of ignoring the neighbor's inferior BPDUs until the max age timer expires, the switch will immediately transition its port to the designated role in the listening state. However, the port still needs to transition through the listening and learning states before forwarding. Okay, let's go to question 3. Which switches should BackboneFast be enabled on? Pause the video now to think about the answer. Okay, the answer is D, all switches in the LAN. Switches without BackboneFast won't send and receive the RLQ request and response messages that are necessary for BackboneFast to work. So, if you want to enable BackboneFast, enable it on all switches. Okay, that's all for the quiz and this video. I hope it was helpful. Thanks for watching. Before finishing this video, let me thank my JCNP level channel members. To become a member, please click the join button under the video. Thanks to Jonathan Makara, Velva Jacob, Funny Dart, George, Nasir Chowdhury, Gustavo BR, Pavel M, Drago Sirneya, Zakib Shah, Mayor Salman, Vitaus194, Chance Carter 56, Mark Jackson, Bold1C1U, Michael Carroll, Gerald Guillaume, Fristas 1207, Gabriel Braga, Hector Hernandez, Mara Tuba, Roji Kuriakos, Arpad Conives, 5 Feet, Owad Daniel Brown, Jose Alvarez, Hussein Yavuz, Kevin Hayes, Samuel Tavares, Roger Bratseth, Mustafa Ersoy, Nasser Zahar, Brian Grant, Georgi Gemajev, Hypocrisy Allergic, Arlen Plagaria, Dear Diso, Adelson Pereira, Farad 69, Joyce Njoroge, Lucien Stoichatoyu, Madmark 50484, Alexandru Stratan, Hiago Bicalho, Pieter Kaimov, DMJ2, Kurt Nell, Omid Farakesh, Steve Cox, Jasper Yim, Wilmer Romero, Laurent Lam, Pedro Hartman, Ivano Capuano, Jefferson Steelflex, Alejandro Okana, Burl Campbell, Abhishek Sahu, Toxic, Sinan Sarisinar, Gio, Daniel Andrade, Jairo Francisco, Mike Crumby, Eliel Eliluli, Dragos George, Vijay Kumar Pili, Andrew Krauska, Random User 7547, Wagner Botelho, and ICTEDU Official. Sorry if I pronounced your name incorrectly, but thank you so much for your support. Thanks to you and my other supporters, I am able to make these videos and release them for free on YouTube, so I really appreciate the support. Another great way to support the channel is to like the video, leave a comment, subscribe, and most importantly, share this video with others. So, if this video was helpful, I'd appreciate it if you did any of those. Thanks for watching.